All right, good morning, good morning. Hello, hello. We are about to start Workshop D, and basically what we're going to be talking about with the help of four great experts is, there we go. We want to talk about a topic that is one of the more perplexing ones in the field of measurement. We often strive for, and in essence, there's a sort of a fundamental tenet to this workshop, and that tenet is that consistency is good. In other words, if you have a measurement in multiple countries, in an ideal world, you would measure consistently across all those geographies. And you can take that concept of geography and you can extend it a bit further. You can say we want to measure consistently across cultures, let's say. Let's say you work for a client that makes multiple brands, and they all measure differently. In fact, I was in Geneva on Tuesday, the new client called Richemont, and they've asked for help measuring consistently across Cartier, Montblanc, and Purdy shotguns. Now, theoretically, the question is, and the question we're going to try to address in this workshop, is, well, how do you do that? And how do you get to that point? And to basically answer, not only how do you measure across time zones, but to answer this question sort of a couple different ways. If you have a global approach, how do you localize it? How do you make a global approach that, let's say, as Dunia will talk about here in a few minutes, that is relevant to UNICEF in New York City, which is where this approach really comes from. How do you make that relevant in Kenya? And on the flip side, how do you ladder up local or regional approaches into, if you will, global, at least, you can't make it consistent all the time, at least to a language that is has something in common with the language of measurement used in other countries. So I want to invite, if I can hit this one more. Okay, here we go. Here's our panel. And this is a panel of experts. And how many of you were in the session just a minute ago, the nonprofit session? Okay, guess who made the video of the kids from UNICEF? Our first speaker, Dunia, come on up. Dunia is not only, she's not only a measurement expert at UNICEF, but also has done a fair amount of the videography and the producing to document the refugee crisis, including the video you just saw in the next room of the two kids in Germany. And you interviewed them both, right? That's what I understand. That was wonderful. Our second speaker, is Takeshi Muro, or if you would like to be polite in Japanese, in Tokyo, say Muro-san. And he works for a company called, come on up, Muro-san. He works for a company called Hakuhodo, where he's a senior producer. If you don't know Hakuhodo, or you don't spend a lot of time in Tokyo, they, along with Dentsu, are the two biggest, basically, integrated marketing communications companies in Japan. I think Hakuhodo has, 12,500, 13,000 employees across all its different organizations throughout the APAC region in particular, and have recently begun to work in the United States as well. Our third speaker is Mark Stevenson. Mark, come on up. Mark and I have been friends for a really long time. We actually worked together in the very first Bush administration, just to really, really date ourselves. Since then, Mark has migrated to even more important things. He is the head of communications, brand, and digital for Philips throughout North America. And our fourth speaker is Jerry Nichols, who you heard from yesterday. He heads up performance management at SAP. So what we're going to do, sorry with you, is ask each of our speakers to spend a few minutes with you and sort of walk through the answers to the question that we're posing, which is basically, if consistency is seen as good, how do you get to consistency? And then after they each talk for a few minutes, I'll pose a couple questions to them and really hope to involve you and get you to really ask the experts here as well. So Dunia, you're first.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, David, for the introduction. As you mentioned, I work at UNICEF in the headquarters in New York. And part of the biggest exercises, I would say, that UNICEF went through is basically focusing on communications and having to develop a global communication and public advocacy strategy. And the way we thought about it is that we did not want to communicate to only communicate or to inform, but we wanted to communicate in order to advocate and bring change for children. And so our underlying thought is that we want to communicate to advocate in order to protect and, again, advocate for the rights of children, and especially the most disadvantaged ones. And so our basic objectives were that we wanted to put children at the heart of the political, socio-economic agendas. We wanted to build key partnerships with the private sectors, with governments, but we also wanted to fuel social movements. So it's, you can think about it almost like a sandwich effect, where we're really working with governments, and it's something that we've done for years. But the next step was, how do we actually have a bottom-up approach where we engage with two target audiences, millennials and middle class, as they were emerging as growing target audiences that were keen on social issues. And so in order to bring the strategy from a conceptual strategy to actually a tangible one, we identified key pillars. And these are voice, reach, and engagement. We wanted to be the leading voice for and with children. We wanted to reach with our voice compelling stories and messages 1 million people, and we wanted to engage amongst these people with 50 million that are gonna be in constant touch with UNICEF, but they're also gonna be taking actions on behalf of the organization. And so once the strategy got buy-in from globally, from the 190 countries of UNICEF, the idea was, how do we move to the next steps? It's very tangible objectives, how do we measure them? And I just want to walk you through like few numbers that we had, and this is from mostly 2015 until today. We started with 80 country offices that expressed their buy-in and said they want to implement the strategy. 53 of these countries were very interested in measurements, and they were keen on measuring the effectiveness of their communications. Working with these countries through capacity building and trainings in order to implement and measure the communication strategy, 30 countries have managed to build the infrastructure of media monitoring and are doing some sort of measurement. But the caveat here is that, and the staggering number, is that only 11 countries are actually reporting continuously on the scorecards. So in order to kind of feed into our strategy, we're noticing that we have a lot of gaps. And so earlier this year, end of 2015, we found ourselves in this, in between two major challenges, I would say. On the one hand, we have a very big vision in which we want to implement a media monitoring framework across all countries implementing the strategy. On the other hand of the spectrum, where we got to understand and realize that there are a set of challenges that we did not think about. And I'll just list them and I'll go through them in the next slides. We are dealing with very diverse contexts. We are in 190 countries. We are dealing with limited resources, a fixed mindset, and missing integration. So going to the first point, what do we mean by diverse contexts? I work in headquarters, and so we in New York, from a global perspective, we have a great collaboration with Ketchum and Gorkana, where we came up with a framework, we developed a solid framework from our perspective. We had a set of KPIs, we're working on regular reporting. But when we decided to take this framework to country offices, we realized that they're very different in their socioeconomic context, in terms of their media landscapes, and also in terms of the internal resources. You're dealing with country offices with a team of communications of 20 people on probably Brazil or Argentina, but then you have a much smaller team in, I would say, Burundi. In terms of media landscape, we're dealing with very digital countries, and I'm excluding actually Europe and North America, but then we're also dealing with countries that are heavily investing or using advocacy through community radio and community leaders. And so sourcing content in these countries becomes very challenging. So what we have done, and what we're still working on, because I think everything that I'm going to mention is something that we're starting and it's work in progress, is to understand and document the conditions in each country. So we get on calls, we talk to country offices, and we try to map, basically, where do they fit? And in other words, we're trying to transform our team into kind of a hub of knowledge, where we can actually link similar countries in order to kind of create some sort of learning between countries with similar conditions. And then, taking even a further step back, is actually we try to focus on measuring or translating the global framework into a communication strategy in the local country that is most aligned with their programmatic priorities, whether it's child protection, whether it's probably environment or education, etc. And the second one is that and you've heard it quite a lot, so I'm not going to spend a lot of time on it, being mindful of time as well, is that we face like a good portion of the countries that we're working with, a scarcity of human and financial resources. Financial resources in order to bring the media monitoring on board, and I think all of us in this field understand that having a media monitoring company is key, especially for traditional media measurement. But then in some other countries, they're actually dealing with one person or one person and a half having to develop a strategy, execute it, write the press releases, and measurement as a result is often an afterthought. And so what we have done here is that we started supporting some country offices with some sort of reporting, given setting as a prerequisite, basically having access to the local resources, having access to content. We would actually work with them together in order to provide some sort of reporting, show the value of measurement, and then kind of incentivize them, and especially their management, to have a buy-in in terms of measurement. And then the other one is that we wanted to explore a regional approach in measurement. So if you guys have seen yesterday's presentation from Microsoft, physical borders do not matter as much as language, and it's something that we experience at UNICEF. So for example, if we have Latin America as a whole continent, actually we could leverage the same kind of conditions there in order to focus on Spanish as a language and try to provide some sort of regional approach and solution that would be shared between different countries. And in this case, the cost is minimized and also the efforts because they can learn from one another. Thirdly, fixed mindset, and it's something that we've heard too, and I'm just reiterating it. We're trying to inculcate a culture of evidence-based measurements as opposed to anecdotal, basically stories where we try to drive conclusions. And with that comes the need for change management, where we need to have the support of the C-suites or the C-level management at UNICEF. We're trying to also make a stronger case. And so just probably to give you an example, I was talking to the Colombia country office last week, and they started like sharing some of the numbers from their scorecards, and you could see like one quarter they would have few thousands of followers on Facebook, and it just like peaks into or on Twitter, and then the next it peaks into millions. And when we started digging into it, it was mostly a need for them to create awareness and engagement about a campaign, and they used paid media. But then looking more into it, they had reached an exponential awareness, but their engagement rates did not change. And it's something that they did not think about until we kind of started diving and slicing and dicing the data. Another approach that we have kind of used is focusing on campaigns. This specific campaign, Bring Back Our Childhood, was one of UNICEF's initiative from the regional office in Western Africa. And it was by working with the Nigerian, as a result of the 200 girls that were abducted by Boko Haram in Nigeria. And UNICEF started this global campaign in order to bring awareness about it and also talk about certain rights of children that were broken as a result of the kidnapping. And so we worked with the regional office, starting from basically giving facts and sharing them with globally. And then we used the lessons learned as a way to change the messaging in the next year, 2016, where we actually talked about the stigma regarding these girls when they actually go back to their communities. And the stories that we told and the quality of the messages had proved to be much more compelling and had much more engagement in terms of storytelling perspective. Lastly, and I think most importantly, is that we're missing integration. The underlying foundation of our strategy is advocacy and engagement. But these two particular elements are not easy to measure. They're not very tangible. Advocacy takes years sometimes in order to move from the minute we talk about an issue until we actually bring change in policy. And so what we're doing, and just probably to be mindful of time, is that we're taking a step back to align our framework to our programmatic work, because that's the closest we get to our strategic objectives. And then we're working with thought leaders. Us being here is a way for us to learn, to go back and to experiment. And talking about experimentation, one of my favorite words is Kaizen. It is what it means it's a way for continuous improvement and change. I hope I did not ruin the definition of it. But it just means that measurement is a journey, it's a loop. We keep iterating, we keep experimenting, and at some point we need to actually go back to our objectives and our strategies and feedback into it, because otherwise I don't think that there is a learning in the process. Thank you.
Thank you. I think, you know, when I introduced you, unlike the other three, whose last names I used as well, I think I only called you Dunya because the last few years I still am trying to pronounce your last name. Which I'll try one last time, Dunya Kashir.
It's a better improvement.
It's an improvement.
It's a very, yeah. It's
or alternatively, like Madonna, you could just be Dunya.
Exactly.
Okay.
And we got a Kaizen. We'll keep learning.
Exactly. So, all right, Muro-san.
So thank you, Dunya, for this transition by Japanese word. So hi, everyone. Thank you for giving such a great opportunity to talk at AMX Summit. I'm Muro from Hakodo Tokyo, an advertising agency group, number 2 in Japan and number 7 worldwide in terms of revenue. My background is PR, and Hakodo emphasizes PR to offer it as a big part in its integrated marketing solutions. We have over 300 PR talents in our group, and I'm in charge of international PR network, including the strategic alliance with Ketchum. So I might be the only Japanese at this summit, so today I'd like to explain the measurement and the evaluation in Japan PR industry. So a government body, Japan Institute for Social and Economic Affairs, conducted a research of over 200 in-house PR persons at major Japanese companies in 2015. For measurement, 48.9% use output goals, such as every ease and number of articles. 28.1% use outcome business performance goals, such as corporate brand rankings and the change of stock price. On the other hand, 30.7% answered they use process goals. So process goals is not the correct English word, but the survey used that word. Such as, you know, number of news releases or number of journalists coming to PR event. This happened mainly in Japan PR head office, and I saw many Japanese companies struggle with international PR and have no global standard measurement ways. So Japanese companies are in the transformational period of communication measurement, and I always advise three things to my clients. The first thing is to see from different than FAEs. So client often ask me to, you know, simple FAEs, but I decline it. Number two, analyze qualitatively to improve your strategy. So simple numbers like FAEs won't improve your strategy. Number three, open eyes to international perspectives. It is very important for Japanese companies to overcome language barrier between Japanese and English, and lack of international PR talents. So this is a project example of a Japanese company's automotive brand. The client launched a global PR headquarters, and we helped the PR measurement project across regions. We set quantitative, qualitative indices, and the most important insight was that the qualitative evaluation of brand design and environmental performance was very different from each other. For example, in terms of design, in Japan it is negatively evaluated, that boring compared to European brands. However, in USA it is fairly evaluated, elegant and comfortable, but can be more unique and exciting. In terms of environmental performance, it is said in Japan, hybrid itself is not a strength, while in the USA, it is said that hybrid is being related to premium product image. From this analysis, we developed successful global key messaging and local adaptation strategies. Japan's domestic market has been so big, so sometimes Japanese companies have underestimated PR and communication measurement abroad. But understanding this kind of gaps of acceptance is very useful for a better strategy. So here is another example on how we evaluate a Japanese company's corporate communication activities. We call this as four quadrant corporate communications analysis. The vertical line is external internal access, and the horizontal line is business society access. The four quadrants stand for marketing, management, employees, and social for reach. Sometimes a client focuses heavily on marketing and management side and is satisfied by PR outputs there, but it has to get media outputs in social employee area if the goal is to build a good corporate reputation as outcome. By combining a qualitative approach like this with quantitative approach, we can develop a better strategy for corporate communications. So here are the five next steps for Japanese companies' international communication measurement. First and foremost, we have to get rid of process goals, so the number of news releases, number of journalists, and simple AVEs from Japan's PR industry by education, so we need your help. Second, Japanese companies should overcome time difference and language barrier to set up an agile international communication measurement structure. Third, some of my clients are already aware that AVEs are not the value of communication, which is Barcelona Principles 2.0, number 5. We need to define standard qualitative measurement ways, quantitative measurement ways such as impressions and cost per million. Fourth, qualitative methods are important to explain results, which is Barcelona Principles 2.0, number 4. For the next step, we'll better define standard measurement ways of how to quantify the quality of outputs and outcomes. Last but not least, as mentioned in Barcelona Principles in 2.0, number 6, social media are to be measured. I'm wondering how to combine social media measurement with other data marketing initiatives. So thank you for listening to my presentation, and I pass to Mark-san now.
Thank you, and it's good to be with you this afternoon. I think many of you know in this room that Philips was one of the early adopters of the Barcelona Principles, and since that time, we have really developed a strong culture in measurement. We actually have develop these across globally and across our borders, across businesses, geographies, etc. It's really been a part and parcel of how we go about our work on a regular basis. And we now, to the point where we now actually measure on a monthly, quarterly, and semi-annual basis. So quite a lot of data coming in, and that's all been a good thing. And we all know that for the things that we all do, you know, the more data, depending on who you are and where you sit, can be the better. I think maybe, David, you might subscribe to that, right? We all feel that it's been a particularly good development for Philips. We didn't have an approach, a global approach. We didn't even have, I think, a regional approach until this time. We're looking at the things that we're doing. I think it's probably, it feels like, though, the measurements that we have been taking since the Barcelona principles have been adopted, feels like we've been doing it since probably the dawn of Barcelona itself, because it's lots of data coming in on a regular basis. So what do we measure? So looking at these graphs, let me just share with you, and this is across the global spectrum. A lot of these will look familiar to you. And we look at message penetration. These are the cornerstones. We do much more than this, but these are the four key elements of measurement across the globe. Message penetration, 2+ messages that have to be in the top half of the article. And if it, I think, gets past graph 3 or 4, it's bupkis, it doesn't count. If you get to then the NPS score, you know, of course, have to have more promoters than detractors, and we try really hard to make sure that that happens in everything we do and incorporate in terms of our work, in terms of messaging and the active, proactive way in which we do that. You'll see two lines, horizontal lines on those graphs above. That's the goal that was set by the Global Office for each of the markets. They're pretty tough, and I'm pleased to say, maybe I'm relieved to say, North America has met and exceeded those goals, so that's nice. Of course, we have share of voice, and we have tonality. And that is fairly much the common elements that Philips looks in terms of in all of its markets. However, in really trying to determine and understand the impact you're having at the market level, got to do something a little bit different. So markets that are diverse, complex, and as large as North America need more than the one size fits all. We need more. We need a 360 degree view. We need more than just outputs. We need outcomes. And we need that to drive insights. And really, for the most part, insights, to me, is critical. It's everything. It's sort of the grease that makes the engine go. And for us, without them, I think we do get a little high-centered in terms of just looking at some of the things in terms of, especially outputs, because for a long time, I think the business was looking at outputs and not getting a sense about whether they're getting that traction. So this is all great, and who can really, if you look at this and look at all the things that we've done, who can argue, if you will, in terms of those global measurements that I just identified, it's a huge achievement within Philips, company that operates in over 200 countries, to achieve some commonality in terms of how it measures itself. It's a little bit like motherhood and apple pie, but you really have to look at, for instance, a market like North America and realize that can only get you so far. So this is why we took this hybrid approach. It's kind of the classical global approach, if you will, and we looked at a few things that provide us with a lot more information that gets us to those insights. And let me share those with you right now. So, PR specifically, these are campaigns, by the way. So we looked at, you look at these four statements, and so if I can read them, if I remember them right, there are aging well business at the top. I believe that's our LED lighting, second, and then we have sleep business, third, and the last one is our oral healthcare. And what we do is we ask this question of our audiences, but we ask them in a way that allows us to understand the impact of our PR campaigns. And so you can see the difference here in terms of those who are PR aware and PR who are not aware, right? It's a big difference. In fact, these deltas in some of those cases are 14. These are just examples. We have many others that relate to all of our businesses. And you can see a similar kind of pattern emerge when it comes to the effectiveness of the DR. So it's one way for us to be able to really get a better understanding about what's driving that effectiveness. On the digital side, now this is just a kind of a high level view of 13 months of kind of traffic, where the traffic is coming from. So it's basically the channels. And you'll see on the left-hand side, of course, the pie chart that kind of does a summary, and then on the right-hand side is the monthly tracking on a 13-month basis. And you can get you can see from where you're sitting all the elements there relate to a particular channel in the digital space. And what that does, we have this, by the way, by campaigns and by business. This is an amalgamation of all those things to kind of give us a sense about what's happening out there in general. But what we're able to do from this is allow us to kind of look at the channel mix and determine the effectiveness in terms of what sort of effort, if it's money or resources behind it to make it work. We also have a brand campaign. In particular, this one is a chart that takes a bit of a temperature on our work in Washington, D.C. We have a business-to-government approach there. And we look at whether or not we're sort of moving the needle, if you will, in terms of building our reputation and our positioning. It used to be when I first came to Phillips not that long ago that our government affairs office said, I can't get in the dark because they don't know who we are. They think we're Milk of Magnesia, or we're an energy company, or we're something else. Strange, because for many of you who live in other parts of the world, Phillips is a better known brand, right? But not so in America. So this is something that became a real challenge for us. So we embarked on an effort there because for Phillips, the U.S. government is the single largest customer we have and has the ability to really leapfrog in terms of where they are currently from a customer standpoint of business. And if you look at these waves that you see in front of the chart, these are waves 1, 2, and 3 over an 18-month period. And what we're seeing is some movement in the right direction, right? But we're also seeing that of those who are aware and these questions that they answer, their engagements are pretty high. And so we're seeing the right direction, we're seeing the right movement in terms of those folks. So we know, and we have some data underneath this to show that the kinds of messaging, the positioning, and the things that we're putting in front of them in terms of that engagement, getting them to seek information, getting them to review reports, getting them to sign on, is having the positive impact that we had hoped. So I'm cutting this kind of short because we have lots of data. So this is apologies for kind of a high-level summary here. But here we are. We took a look at 5 statements, and we said, okay, how do our key audiences view us as it relates to favorability and some other elements that you see on that chart there? And what we wanted to do is check it from the advertising as well as a PR point of view, and then also both. So it gives us a good sense, and we of course also have this dissected into what those channels are underneath that. But what it tells us is what's really kind of driving our results. And what you can see plainly is that it's the combination, maybe not too surprising to all of you, but at least it's validation and confirmation that in fact the combination is working here, and the more that you go down that list of statements, in terms of agreement, you'll get a consistent response to that. And that's giving us really keen insight in terms of being able to share with us some information that's helpful to, Dunia's point, kind of that virtuous circle of, correction and or enhancement as you go, be it campaign by campaign or kind of year to year. And the other chart that I didn't bring with me today is one that actually is just as sort of interesting sort of indicates and correlates to this, is if an individual who our target audience touches us once, for instance, they see a Sonicare toothbrush commercial, they have a particular point of view in terms of favorability of X. But if they see that and they also see a lighting commercial or touched by a thought leadership program, it's X plus plus. Right. And if it's a third touch, it's X plus plus plus. And so the insight we draw from that, and that's all across the board, by the way, the insight we draw from that is the more they know us, the more they like us. And those are huge insights for us to be able to kind of take forward into the campaigns that we develop and nurture for the future. So this is, I want to share this with you because these are the kinds of deep measurements that we do in the market. We do share this with the other markets so they can benefit from this to the extent that they have some correlating kind of challenges and opportunities. And for us, the hybrid approach, this global approach, is really the one that wins for us. And I just appreciate the opportunity to be here, and I'll turn it over to you.
Excellent. Thank you. Hi, everybody. Happy to be here today to share with you, you know, some of our experiences at SAP. And, you know, one thing that's important to note here is that SAP is a very, being a German company, is a very process-oriented company. You know, our measurement approach doesn't align 100% to the Barcelona principles, but they're fundamentally the same construct. Interesting, you know, one of the questions of how do you measure consistently across time zones and countries? Well, one thing that we have at SAP is our strategic KPIs are built into our compensation program. So that means how the organization performs on its strategic KPIs at a global level, at a market unit level, determines individual compensation. So that really gives it some teeth in terms of people aligning to our KPIs and what we're doing. In terms of, you know, our overall process, you know, for making metrics matter, you know, similar to some of the content yesterday, is we really start off with, you know, establishing strategic objectives, right? So at the end of the day, you know, what is it that we're trying to achieve? From that, we develop a specific measurement plan in terms of what success looks like. We implement the measurement plans in terms of measuring, benchmarking, testing, communicate the results on a regular basis, action planning, and also continuous improvement. So what this does is it really provides us a platform both within our individual market units, region, and globally to define what success is and to know whether or not we're meeting our goals. Through this process, we have action planning to identify best practices and also areas for opportunities and improvement. You know, we review our strategic objectives on a monthly basis as part of quarterly business reviews, including regional breakdowns, and that's where we start to see where there's any strong performers or areas that need attention. In terms of, you know, what we did for our overall Run Simple campaign, this does tie to our strategic objectives, and this was really, you know, our premier campaign to introduce SAP HANA through our Run Simple messaging. Our KPIs were set at a global level, but they were also measured at a market unit level as well in the key markets where the campaign was live. So we looked at our perception KPIs, we looked at our year-over-year increase in earned brand mentions. Now, what's important here is to make our social media monitoring relevant. We actually translated, not only doing our social media monitoring in English, but in the top eight languages of our 10 market units. So we actually did our social listening in about eight different languages. And what this did is this enabled folks within the region to develop their own specific KPIs around this at a market unit level and have local language translations that made sense. We also had our brand tracker to measure our purchase consideration. And from a demand generation perspective, we measured our leads, our pipeline build, and our software license revenue. In terms of some of the guiding principles of our measurement plan, you know, it's aligned to the overall definition of what success is. We aligned it to the customer journey, the media plan, and also the channel strategy. Define the high-level customer journey as awareness, education, intention, purchase, and advocacy. And these are standards that are applicable across the globe. It's not just a US thing, it's not just a Japan thing, it's not just a French thing. They're applicable across the globe, and we do the translations into the local market units to understand what the performance is. The performance measures include digital metrics, social media monitoring, our brand health, traditional media coverage, and also demand generation performance. In terms of the overall measurement plan itself, this is really the operational component of our advertising campaign. You know, we couldn't wait to the end of the campaign to find out, hey, we're not meeting our perception goals or we're not meeting our demand generation goals. We really have to inspect each phase of the customer journey along the way to identify any weaknesses in the system. You can't wait till the end of the year and kind of open up the envelope and see how you did there. In terms of, you know, the measurement plan itself, focus on the key tenets of awareness, education, intention, purchase, and advocacy. And we identify along the way very specific metrics along the journey. So, you know, in this, you know, you never quite know what you're going to find. It's also important for us to understand what our competitors are doing. Some of our key competitors outspend us 15 times or 3 times more annually. And so that's going to have a very significant impact on our ability to own a particular brand attribute or also familiarity. So you have to have kind of that backstage of what your competitors are doing to set the bar. Some of the other types of metrics that we looked at as part of our awareness were visits to our website, our social media engagement rates, et cetera. So as part of this, what we did is we looked at numerous comparison points. We compared against industry benchmarks. We compared to pre-post campaigns, monthly benchmarks, quarterly benchmarks, and also year-over-year benchmarks. And then also measures. So we reported out our results from our operational measurement plan within each of our market units, both pre and post campaign. And then these laddered up to, at the end of the year, at a global level, what our overall strategic KPI performance. So if you look at this, this aligns to 100% what I mentioned in the very beginning in terms of looking at our purchase consideration, our earned brand mentions, our leads, our pipeline coverage, and our revenue. So we use the operational measurement kind of in between to understand with what ease we're executing on our campaign, which we'll also pick up eventually in our strategic KPIs in terms of what we define as success at the very beginning. It's also very important that you communicate results. We leveraged infographics to really help communicate within the organization for folks that may not be as technical in a way that was really fun and generated excitement for our efforts overall. Thank you.
Thank you.
So we have a few minutes left, and my job as moderator is to keep this right on time. So rather than me ask questions, why don't we see for questions here in the audience, and if you hadn't thought of one right away, here's a couple of options you might consider, Mary.
Thank you. Anyone across the panel might choose to answer this. One of the greatest challenges across cultures is always measuring advocacy. Recommendation for brand, because it can be so difficult to get it from one market to another. You know, obviously I'm thinking from an Asian perspective, and some markets are much more willing to recommend a brand than others. That makes for challenges, perhaps from a Philips point of view in NPS, how you score it, from an SAP point of view, and how you get recommenders around your brand. And then I'm sure, Muto-san, you have experience in Japan. Trying to get recommendation is extremely difficult as well.
So we get it from a couple places at SAP. One, we use some of our social media monitoring. We use sentiment as a proxy for advocacy. We also pick it up from our always-on brand tracker, asking prospects how likely they are to recommend. And then within our company overall, we have a net promoter score that's executed by our sales organization. So those are the three places we get it.
Yeah. Similar, I mean, you saw my slide on the NPS, so that's throughout the organization, not just in the comms world, but also in the business world, of course. But we also do a brand tracker as well in terms of their willingness to advocate on our behalf in terms of issues or anything else. And so we have that number on the brand side. And then we do have some, in terms of some, we have some correlation with advocacy related to engagement, depending on the social side, that we do some correlation, although we know there's some gaps there, but that's where we look at it.
Yeah, so we have sort of our internal social media monitoring system, and we are doing social listening and how people recommend the brand, so we will measure that.
At UNICEF, we do as well. I mean, brand measurement, and there's a brand barometer research that goes on every year. But from a public advocacy perspective towards policy change, we still did not crack the code, to be honest. We're still working with different parts of UNICEF because we do realize that at the end of the day, communications is a support function. So we need to communicate about our programmatic priorities. The idea is that we want to align our measurements as much as possible with the way they measure. So the way, for example, child protection section would measure their performance and contribution to the organizational objective, we will use it and try to insert ourselves in their measurement framework. So it's work that we are still developing. I hopefully next year we'll have the clear answer on how we're really getting into a clearer model, but the idea is we stopped actually talking about an attribution for change, but rather a contribution. So we have a smaller piece of the pie, but not the entire pie for sure.
Thomas?
So this is a kind of half-formed thought and question, so I hope the panel can help me make it a bit more complete.
Now remember, Thomas, you stumped the CEO panel yesterday. They had no clue how to answer, so give it a shot.
So Tom Standage, the deputy editor of The Economist, wrote a book recently called Writing on the Wall, Social Media in the First 2000 Years. His base premise is that this whole business of traditional mass media and one-to-many communication is the real historical blip. He said what's called new media right now is actually really, really old media because, you know, you can find equivalents for Facebook and Twitter and so on in Roman history, and they actually had wax tablets that look a lot like iPads. That's a different story. The point I'm trying to make is when we look at consistency of evaluation, you know, we apply mass media models because that's our understanding. So we have lots and lots of data, and we're applying now the same principles to social media. Maybe to a certain extent, you know, we're on the wrong track when we want to do this cross-culturally. Because it works for the US, it works for the UK and so on. But when we go across culture, maybe we should focus a lot more on social media and where consistency of sort of human behavioral drivers come from. So is that something that resonates with the panel, or am I completely on the wrong track?
I could actually take a kind of a little crack at this. I'll try. I totally agree with you. And I think one of the best things I've heard in the past is that we need to stop talking about, you know, social media as the end. It's actually a means to communications. Word of mouth existed years ago, but it's just now that the platforms are different, and the difference now is that we can measure it as opposed to, you know, just like hearing things and hearing, you know, rumors. So now it's much more measurable in a way. And I think the answer from a measurement perspective is that we need to go beyond the output level and go to the outcomes. What sort of perceptions are we getting? What sort of awareness are we building? And what sort of behaviors are we changing? So going to the emotional aspects and the behavioral side of it is, I think, gives a depth and a meaning to the data that we're generating. So for as long as we're gonna talk about Facebook fans, for example, and Twitter followers are two different things, I think we're not gonna get the answer. The way to do it, I guess, is still a question mark, but again, probably next year we'll have the answer. But I think our thoughts are aligned in this sense.
So I'm from a Japanese advertising agency, so and we have PR group in advertising agency. So we offer integrated marketing solutions to the client. After the campaign, we sometimes conduct consumer research, including paid media, owned media, earned media, in the same research. So I think the measurement across the media can be possible. It is possible, I think.
I think it's possible, but I don't think we're there yet. I think we have to find a way to normalize the data from the things that we're used to the things that we're going to in terms of the social aspect of our business. I work with a lot of other colleagues that have a similar position in the States, and they all feel the same way. They feel that we're only in the infancy stage, if you will, of trying to really understand this, and everyone's still grappling it. So because of that, everyone has their own standard or interpretation of what that all means. So it's a journey that we've got to get started. I think it comes back to the standardization or the normalization so that data to understand really the value of it and what that means to us and gaining insights.
So for us, it's really looking at two aspects of it. As you mentioned, I agree with you, it's a journey. We started first just measuring the volume of our social media interactions, and now we're doing a lot of work around leveraging the quality of our social media interactions. So how are people interacting with our content? Are they liking it? Are they sharing it, et cetera? So it's not just about the pure volume, but how can we maximize the type of social media that we are creating to get folks to engage with our content. That's kind of the next step that we're starting to focus on now, is the quality of our social media interactions.
So we are right at the top of the hour, which means lunchtime. And just to finish up, something you may or may not know about AMET is that it is a highly, highly, highly competitive environment. But it's not a competitive environment between a PR agency like Ketchum, mine, and Marion's at Ogilvy, or Megan with Cortana, and Jonna with Burrell's Loose. It is a competitive environment among moderators of panels. So when you give them the round of applause you're about to, make sure the people in the next room wish they had been in this one instead, all right? Thank you very much.